thing, if there's a danger, if you try to sell too hard to someone at first and they say no, or they don't need your services, you may have cut off that conversation. Whereas if you allow it to happen, it may be then that when that person is ready, they start to have a conversation with you. We do exactly the same in real life. When we put this networking label on things, we tend to confuse things. You know, there are, just trying to think of what various members of my family do. But no, you know, regardless of what they do, if I need a particular service, the likelihood is that if I've got a family member or a close friend who I get on with who provides that service, I'm likely to pick up the phone and talk to them first. We need a number of services at the moment. We're looking within the family and within the friends and so on to secure those services. We'll do that first. So if you build a network, there's every chance that when someone needs that service, they'll consider you first. It doesn't mean you're a shoo-in. I think that's a misunderstanding that people have as well. But it means people are much more likely to at least start the conversation with you before they go to Google, before they pick up the, do people still pick up the Yellow Pages? Before people do that, you know, you've put yourself at the front of the queue. Yeah. And that's, you know, that unfair advantage is something that all of us are trying to achieve in business, so that if someone needs a speaker or if someone needs a network or networking training, I've consistently put myself in a position over years that people either come to me or recommend me and at least give me the chance to quote, rather than people just having to find me and not know who I am. That's what we can achieve with networking. But I'll go back to the point. Not everyone in the room is going to need your services today. In fact, no one in the room might need your services today, but that isn't a reason to stop going. And I've got no axe to grind these days. I'm not involved in running networking events anymore, but my advice is still consistent that people should turn up regularly and turn up over a period of time, because that's when it actually works for people.
That consistency is so important, isn't it? And the way I've often looked at that, you know, one of the big differences between my approach to networking events today compared to 7 or 8 years ago when I was an active hotelier, is understanding that it's the consistency just of turning up. And that is just as important a reflection of your credibility to a potential customer who happens to be in the room. That, you know, we all want reliability, honesty, trustworthiness from people that we work with. And surely the fact that, well, he's become a member of this event that's on a Wednesday morning every 2 weeks, the fact that you show up and you turn up consistently, regularly, that is actually a really important but subliminal part of building the credibility and the trust, isn't it?
Yeah, completely. If someone only turns up when they've got something to sell, they become known as the person who's only got, you know, only there when they want to sell you something. But equally, just as you get to know your family by seeing them regularly, you get to know, you know, before all of this happened, I would go to the pub. You get to know the people in the pub over a period of time. You get to know the people who go networking. So you then start to make the decision. They talk a lot in networking about the meet, like, know, trust, or the know, like, and trust, depending on which flavor of networking you go to. But the more you get to know people, the more they've got at least a chance to decide whether they trust you or not, whether they trust you to do the work that you've said you're going to do, or for them to refer you. If they hardly ever see you, they've got much less chance to make that decision. And it's degrees of trust as well. For me for someone to buy a book costs them £10 there or thereabouts. You know, that takes a very small degree of trust. For me to organise my annual conference at your event, if you're a hotel or venue owner, for me to organise my conference at your venue, rather, it takes a great degree of trust. Mm. Because it's, you know, we're only running our conference once a year. We need to make sure it all goes according to plan. So it needs time for someone to build up that trust in you thinking specifically about the hospitality sector, so that someone, you know, let's say someone's wedding, that's going to take a huge amount of trust for someone to put their wedding at your venue, because they want everything to be absolutely perfect that day. So it's, you know, I may turn up at an event and on one meeting, someone might buy a book from me. It takes a little bit more trust for them to maybe buy a course from me to put me on stage at their annual conference. Once again, they need to make sure everything goes according to plan on the day. So that takes a great deal more trust. So it's going to take a bit more effort from me in building the relationship. I need to make sure that person knows me a bit better. And so I go to all of that effort of putting myself in front of people, whether it's in real life or virtually, so that we build the trust up. And that's something that the hospitality can learn as well. The more they're there, the more people get to know them, the more likely they are to trust them to at least make an inquiry with them.
Mm, yeah, it's so true what you're saying there of, you know, those varying levels of trust. Yet it's something that, you know, with my friends and colleagues within the hospitality world, I see varying degrees of understanding of that. And you've just reminded me of a situation I found myself in, probably going back 12 or 14 years, running a provincial hotel just outside London, in Essex. We were one of the 5 minutes off the M25, and there's so many of those kind of towns around the southeast. Three main hotels in the town, my one, a Swallow Hotel, a Moat House, and ironically, three principal employers within the town as well. One was a chemical pharmaceutical firm, one was a warehousing distribution plant, and the other one was a big wholesaling book publisher, ironically. Now, what tended to happen there was that the three core sources of business moved the business around from one hotel to another. And we'd reflecting back on it, we got quite complacent that, oh, this year I'll have their business. They'll probably go to the other hotel down the road next year. But I know that the pharma company, they'll come to me for next year because they've been at that other hotel and they'll get a bit fed up. Now, I'd always like to be quite a visible person, when it, you know, visible leader within the businesses that I ran. And one of the things I tended to do was just hang around reception at the busy times, you know, when I knew most of my guests were checking in, just to be visible and to be there if people wanted to have a chat, but without pouncing on my customers and making them feel uncomfortable. Yeah. And I remember having a chat one evening with one of my regulars who was checking in. Hadn't seen him for a wee while. And we're just having a chat away. It's nice to see you back. You know, have you been away? Well, yeah, you know, it depends which of the hotels I can get a room booked into, because I tend to book at the last minute. But I always prefer coming here. Okay, that's interesting. Can I be cheeky? Can I ask, why is it that you prefer coming here? And the answer, I mean, I still remember the answer 12, 14 years later. And he said, you know what, there's three hotels in this town. You're all much the same. You know, the rooms are the same size. You're about the same cost. When I go everywhere else, I'm just a number. I'm just Mr. Smith from that company. He said, when I come here, you know that my name's John and you talk to me like a human being. And it just kind of feels a bit less like I'm away from home. I don't really welcome to be here.
There's a venue quite local to here. And the marketing manager from there has been doing a lot of networking locally. And he just comes along as a nice guy, and we all know where he is. And me and someone else, just before lockdown, needed a face-to-face meeting. So we said, oh, we'll meet there. And, you know, we just sat in one of the lounges and had a couple of cups of tea. And he walked past. He walked past and said, oh, Steph, Helen, how are you? Great to see you, and so on. And again, I'm not after free stuff here, but when I went to pay for the two cups of tea on the way out, the receptionist said, oh, no, Brendan spotted that you were here, just wanted to say that those were on him. What's the chance, when we get back to real life, when I'm reorganizing the networking retreat, that I now feel, for the sake of whatever it was, £6 worth of tea, that I now feel obliged to actually pick up the phone and say, go on then, let's see what we can do with the networking retreat. So just by being a bit more human, as your friend was saying, not treating me as just, walking past and ignoring us would have been okay. He was busy. Walking past and acknowledging us by name was a second thing. And actually that last little touch at the end means that I'm remembering that story and talking to you about it. And whenever I come to do something, I know that I'll pick up the phone to him and talk to him about it in future, because he's shown me that he cares about me. He's been visible. I know who he is. It's now not just a building, that hotel. I know one of the guys who works in there, and all of that stuff just adds up for me. And once again, it's up until now, I've not needed his services, but as the world opens up again, he certainly put himself at the front of the queue for me to pick up the phone and talk to. And I think it is that. It is remembering that we're human. It is being a bit more human about it. And again, once we put the sort of networking label around things, often people forget that. They forget that we're all people, no matter what our title is, no matter what business we're running, that we're all people and we like to be treated like that.
Absolutely. And I'd be interesting to get your take on this. I think there's actually a huge opportunity for hoteliers, restaurant owners, pub owners, as the country starts to reopen. And now, in the four parts of the UK, I think we've all got a pretty clear route map now of when things are going to start to be able to reopen. And, in Scotland, we got dates, we got markers in the sand yesterday. So it now means that hotel owners, pub owners and such, we can start working towards when we can reopen the doors. And of course, the thing is, it's not just a case of unlocking the door and opening them up. There's a lot of work to be done before then. But I think particularly for hoteliers, there's a huge challenge to rebuild that sales funnel in the business, especially for meetings, conferencing and events. There's a lot of talk of the pent-up demand for leisure travel, and I believe that's true. There's a lot of signals that really is true, but it's only one segment. And if you've got a property that has meeting space, that has conferencing space, you've got a big challenge on your hands to rebuild that sales funnel. And I strongly believe that raising your profile and getting involved in networking in your local community will be a big, big part of being able to do that. One, because not many people do it. So there's a huge opportunity for people to get involved there. But that building your awareness in the local market, I think, is often overlooked, but it's so important. Now, I think something that we'd spoken about before in a previous life, you were an estate agent. And if I remember rightly, I think that's how you actually started to get involved in the networking world, wasn't it, when you were an estate agent? Now, from one or two people I know that are in the property world, there's a pool of people that just kind of sit back and wait for vendors to come to you. You've got to sell a house, I'll go and find an estate agent. And by contrast, there's those who network and who build their awareness and build their profile so that people are actually attracted towards you. And I think a lot of the same thing happens, especially within the hotel sector. It's so easy to get comfortable and get a little bit complacent that we just sit back and say, we've got these great facilities, the world will come to us. But it just doesn't happen like that, does it?
No, it doesn't. And estate agents typically aren't very good at networking for the same reasons that we've talked about with everyone else. Looking at a couple of real life examples down here, Paul Spink, who I did a video interview myself the other day, who owns a venue down here called Fat Lil's, which is a music venue. He's also got a restaurant next door, and he's got one of the pubs in the same street as well. He's been keeping in touch with people through the Facebook page for the business, through his own personal Facebook page, telling us all what's going on at the venue whilst it's shut down, the behind the scenes stuff. They're doing takeaways and that sort of thing. He's been keeping in touch with people throughout. So it's going to be absolutely seamless, absolutely easy for him to keep in touch with people now as we're approaching when he's going to open his doors again. Firstly, in the street, and then he'll be able to invite people in later on. For a load of, I hate to say it, but more corporate venues, there's been no communication from them at all. So now they've got to start again. So you know, Paul at Fat Lils, they've been doing a lot of behind the scenes, the human side of things. This is what we've been doing. I'm out doing the deliveries tonight and so on and so forth. They've been, so we've all seen what their life looks like. My son works at a place called the Queen's Head in Ensham, and also they've been, you know, this is what we're doing when we're shut. This is, you know, how we're bringing things up to date and how we're doing our takeaways and so on. And so people have been kept in touch through Facebook, Instagram, the very modern ways of keeping in touch with people. So many of the more corporate venues haven't done anything, so they've got to start again from cold. It's just networking. It's just networking. Those guys have kept the relationships warm, whereas other guys have now got to start the relationships again from pretty much cold, because we've not seen them since the end of last year when they were last open. That's really interesting to me. It is always the case that owner drivers tend to sort of get this a little bit better. But it's that ability that we've got now to keep in touch with people, which again, estate agents don't typically see, because you not only need to be there, but you need to be there at the point at which someone thinks about selling a house. And you need to be there consistently so they trust you enough when they're thinking about selling a house to approach you. All of that still applies, and all of that has still applied through lockdown to the businesses who actually get it. So the story is pretty consistent. It is about, it's about being visible and being visible for the right reasons. And the right reason isn't that you're only turning up because you've got something to sell to people and you're going to start selling to them when you first meet them. That's, yep. Yeah, I think I've probably said the same thing in slightly different ways over the last 20 minutes or so several times.
Brilliant. Well, I think, you know, there's a world of opportunities there. And you know, we've collaborated on some things before, Stefan, and, you know, for the audience who are out there who need help in rebuilding that sales funnel and getting ready to reopen, but particularly for those who recognise that actually they could raise their profile that bit further, they could be having more conversations and building that network further for their business, then obviously, you know, there's a wealth of help available to them. We could spend all day chatting about this, Stefan, but time is precious to us all. The one last thing I would say, it's bound to have resonated with some people watching this interview. How can people carry on the conversation with you, Steph? Where can they find you?
Oh, thank you. Go and find me on LinkedIn or Facebook. I'm sure you'll tag me in this when you put it out. So find me on LinkedIn or Facebook are the better places to find me, and people can continue conversing with me there. I always thought my name was unusual, but a guy who recently lost whatever it was, 600 million worth of Bitcoin, has got exactly the same name as me. So I'm the guy who writes books about networking. I'm not the guy who lost a lot of money on Bitcoin. I've had so many messages in the last 6 weeks from people who can help me find my password. It's not me, I promise. But yeah, go and search for me on LinkedIn and Facebook, and I've got a relatively unusual name. You should be able to find me there.
Absolutely fantastic. Stefan, on that note, or someone would say on that bombshell, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thanks for making the time to join us today. And you know what? I'm really looking forward to that time, probably not too far away, where we can share a wee beer and actually see each other eye to eye again.
Yeah, I'll really look forward to it. And I'm sure it will be more social than business this time, because we've got a lot of catching up to do. So yeah, thank you for your time as well.
Pleasure. Stefan, thanks a lot.